Well, good evening and welcome to Future Melbourne Network's second public meeting and debate on creating a better future for Melbourne. My name is Michael Short. I'd like to begin by acknowledging the traditional owners and custodians of the land on which we meet today, the Wurundjeri people of the Kulin Nation. I pay my respects to their elders, both past, present, and indeed future. We're here to talk tonight about the future of this land that so many cherish and want to make an even better place in which to work and in which to live for a growing population. Our city is tipped to grow from its current population of about 4.25 million to as many as 7 million by 2050. The Future Melbourne Network is an example of community leadership and has been created by a group of passionate people. They're people who want the place to be safe. They want the place to be environmentally clean and sustainable. They want the place to be socially inclusive. And they want it to be economically robust and successful. And they want this for all citizens. It's hard not to share those goals. You can find out more about them online. You just type into your search engine futuremelbournenetwork.org. Okay, so tonight's community brainstorming session is called Making Ends Meet, Jobs and Housing. I would argue that the greatest form of social justice is a job, and yet so many do not have an equal opportunity to get work. And the importance of decent and affordable housing is self-evident. We need to talk about a range of options, a range of densities, rather than remain wedded to the notion of a sprawling family home on a suburban acre, quarter-acre block. And then there's the troubling reality, of course, that so many people are homeless in such a wealthy city, indeed one of the world's wealthiest cities. I mentioned community leadership a moment ago. Leadership is often confused with hierarchy and management. Rather, I think it's really about asking a simple question. Is this right? When what is the case is far from what ought to be the case, then I think we should fight for change. We should be activists. When what is the case is what ought to be the case, we ought to be radically conservative, if I can put it that way. We should be fighting for the status quo. I don't believe we should be identifying ourselves on some sort of linear ideological scale of left to right. It's become almost meaningless. These terms mean different things to different people in different places, and I think that that sort of ideological language is unhelpful to debate about ideas. It also misses another important axis. You have left to right, but what about authority to anarchy? Where do you fall in that 360 degrees? So I would encourage people to stop using terms like left and right and use clear language about the ideas that you actually mean. The most important marketplace that we have is the free market for ideas. And that is what tonight is about. There are some exceptional experts who will be up here this evening, and I'll introduce them in a moment. Before I do, though, I'd like to acknowledge and thank the sponsors. Housing Choices Australia, thank you very much. RMIT University, thank you very much. Future Leaders, thank you. And Fed Square, thank you very much. Tonight's speakers have profound knowledge and profound experience. They are Tony Nicholson. Tony's the Executive Director of the Brotherhood of St. Laurence here in Melbourne. We have Marcus Spiller, who is Principal Partner and Director of SGS Economics and Planning. We have Shane Murray, who is the Dean of the Faculty of Art, Design and Architecture at Monash University. And we have Carol Whitzman, who's Professor of Urban Planning at the University of Melbourne. Tony Nicholson, as I said, is the Executive Director of the Brotherhood of St. Laurence here in Melbourne. He's dedicated over 30 years to improving conditions of those living on or close to the edges of society. So jobs and housing are right up his alley, if I may say so. A feature of his work has been his ability to collaborate with other social justice organisations, with governments, and with businesses to achieve reform in public policy and service delivery to the benefit of disadvantaged people in our community. He brings to the task of leadership at the Brotherhood a strong record of service, development and innovation, research and policy analysis. He brings compelling advocacy on behalf of those in need and who are disadvantaged in our community. Tony, welcome. Thank you.
Well, thank you, Michael, and good evening, ladies and gentlemen. It's great to be here for this exchange of ideas around these critical issues. For several years now, we at the Brotherhood of St. Laurence have really spent a lot of time expressing our concern about the way in which our public policies, particularly our social policies, lag inordinately behind the big changes that we've seen in the last 30 years in our economy and also in our society. So if you think over the last 30 years about our society, we've seen massive changes to things like household formation, to gender roles, to the distribution of caring responsibilities, both for our youngsters but also for our elderly, and big changes in the life course patterns. We're spending a lot longer time in education, and as the Federal Treasurer has pointed out, we're going to spend a lot longer phasing into retirement, into the future. But right throughout that 30 years, we've also seen some massive changes in our economy. And particularly I point to the way in which employers in the modern internationalised knowledge-based economy increasingly are placing a premium on education and skills and flexibility, particularly flexibility in where you work and when you work and the hours you work. And so in recent times, I spent quite a lot of my time at the Brotherhood documenting how the failure of our social policies to keep up with these social and economic changes has left large numbers of people in our community struggling, really left them behind, despite that 30 years representing an unprecedented period of prosperity that most of us enjoyed. But I want to put to you tonight that our planning policies, our urban planning policies, equally lag behind these economic and social changes that I've talked about. And increasingly, this lag in our planning policies is to blame for some of the social ills that are emerging in our great city of Melbourne. Because the reality of our modern sprawling city is that increasingly we find those at risk of poverty and disadvantage of all types at the fringe, at the outskirts of our great metropolis. At the outskirts where housing is cheapest, but where it is located a long way from where there's any density of jobs. And we know that if you have a decent place to live in and you have a job, then generally most of us are able to build a good life for ourselves in this city. But it's on the outskirts where there's little public transport, there's minimal health and welfare infrastructure, and when schools and kindergartens are really struggling to keep pace with the growth in population. If you look at a suburb like Wyndham alone, is producing two prep classes of babies each week. That's the massive population growth that's going on and that city is struggling to keep up with. And it's on the outskirts where we see now emerging low levels of educational attainment amongst our young people. We also see some of the highest rates of reports of domestic violence and some of the highest rates of reports of child protection. And even in some of these modern suburbs, we see already emerging, and the Brotherhood staff report to me, already emerging youth homelessness in a suburb like Carolyn Springs. And it's on the outskirts where, not by chance, we find levels of youth unemployment at 15% in the north and west. has three times the adult rate of unemployment in these areas. And we see the fastest growing rates of youth unemployment in the outer eastern suburbs of Melbourne. So the conclusion I draw from all of this is that the way in which we are shaping our city is shaping life chances. And unfortunately for too many, that's for the worst. But I do want to say it's increasingly becoming also a determinant of economic productivity. Because with an ageing population in the decades ahead, the proportion of people of workforce age declines. So this means that the quality of our human capital, and that's been one of Victoria's and Melbourne's economics advantages over many years, the quality of our human capital and the maximum use of it becomes a critical challenge to our economy. In the decades ahead, we simply won't be able to afford to have large numbers of people not being able to fully participate in our economy. And that's bad news for all of us. But here's the rub. Both the quality and utilisation of our human capital will in large part, I would contend, depend upon how our city facilitates citizens in being healthy and well-educated and being able to participate in the labour market and fully in social and civic life. So if our children are to prosper, the way in which we plan our city must reflect the realities of societal changes I've talked about, of household formation, of gender roles, in the distribution of caring responsibilities, and in the life course itself. Melbourne, in the decades ahead, will need to enable good transitions from unemployment to employment, and in and out of caring roles, in education and training, and into retirement. And how all this is to be reflected spatially becomes all important. Now, it's interesting that policymakers right around the world are beginning to realise that in the decades ahead, there will be an increasing interdependency between social and economic policies. So the overarching challenge for Melbourne, I would contend, is how it's going to facilitate that type of integration. That won't be achieved if we simply continue the pattern of recent decades of adding on to a car-dependent sprawl. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen.
Tony, thank you. Dr. Marcus Spiller is a principal, is a partner, and is a director of SGS Economics and Planning. His consultancy experience spans land economics, regional development, housing policy, infrastructure funding, and policy coordination systems. He's taken up secondments as a lecturer in urban economics at University of Melbourne, advisor to the Minister for Planning and Housing in Victoria, and as a senior executive in the Queensland Department of Housing, Local Government and Planning. He's an adjunct professor in urban management at the University of Canberra. He's a former member of the National Housing Supply Council. And Marcus is a former national president of the Planning Institute of Victoria. Marcus, thank you and welcome.
So cities change much, much faster than you think, and sometimes very abruptly. They don't dreamily drift along like this moon afloat of the 1960s. Two generations ago, when I was growing up in Carlton, it was regarded as an out-and-out slum, suited only to newly arrived migrants. Now it vies for one of the most sought-after addresses in the world, dare I say. 25 years ago, property market experts were confidently condemning the City of Melbourne's policies to encourage downtown housing. Australians, they said, just didn't want to live that way. Well, today the city of Melbourne has one of the nation's fastest growing populations in absolute terms. 20 years ago, our state government attempted to close the Upfield, Williamstown and Alamein railway lines because of stagnant or dwindling patronage. Try getting a seat on those trains today. At the same time as these shifts and trends have become more dynamic, we have managed to lumber ourselves with institutional structures and a development industry which is painfully slow to respond. And this puts our shared aspiration for a prosperous, sustainable and inclusive city at grave risk. The biggest shift that we have struggled to come to terms with is the one that Tony's just been discussing, and that is that suburban growth areas are no longer the land of opportunity that they once were. In fact, I fear we are holding on to a she'll be right attitude to that outward urban growth. At the height of the post-war boom, most of the best jobs were being created in the new suburbs, in the likes of GMH, Ford, Nissan and International Harvester. This was a time of vertically integrated manufacturing, where managerial and intellectual problem-solving occupations were located in or near the factories. Widespread access to the car expanded and lubricated the labour market, making it prodigiously more efficient. As soon as they could, and it didn't take long, workers who saw themselves trapped in substandard inner city terraces made for the burbs. Many of our Italian neighbours in Carlton gleefully accepted what they saw as generous compensation for their slum-declared homes and escaped to brand new and or much more commodious houses in the then growth areas of Reservoir, Epping, Laylor, Thomastown, Doncaster and Bulleen. Vertically integrated manufacturing was fatally undermined as the platform for the metropolitan economy from the 70s onwards. Australian firms faced a barrage of intense competition from the Asian tigers, then led by Japan, and the terms of trade turned against us as a nation then dependent on commodity exports. Like enterprises the world over, Victorian firms have had to outsource production to lower cost regions, invest in design, buy in smart advice and all manner of business challenges, and create relationships with specialist companies to take care of the non-core aspects of their businesses. Whereas once, almost all of the thinking, making and brokerage action took place within the factory walls or close by, the thinking part of the value chain has now become uncoupled from the making part, at least in a geographic sense. Population-serving jobs like health, education and retail continue to follow their customers wherever they locate. But today, in sharp contrast to the past, specialised problem-solving businesses or outsourced thinking jobs are overwhelmingly drawn to the inner city. From 1961 to 1991, total employment in the city of Melbourne on its current boundaries declined steadily to reach slightly more than 200,000 jobs. Today, the same area is pushing at 500,000 jobs, all fuelled by this dramatic restructuring of the economy under our feet. The linkages to other firms and access to skills offered by the inner city enables these problem-solving, high-paying companies to prosper in a way that they could not elsewhere in the metropolis or the state. And meanwhile, the jobs-to-housing balance in the outer areas continues to deteriorate. Imagine a marketing and communications firm located in Fitzroy or the Docklands or Melbourne CBD, with a staff of skilled professionals and a turnover of around $2 million. To get this outfit to move to Dandenong, you'd need to offer the owners an inducement of around $200,000 per year, because that's the value of the productivity loss they would have to deal with in their new suburban location. To get them to move to Werribee, you'd need to pay them $250,000 a year. The same is true for households. They gain an income boost by locating in accessible, well-connected areas. That's why the competition for inner and middle suburban housing is fierce, and why it is now virtually impossible for a moderate or lower income household to buy a house within 15 kilometres of the CBD, and it's getting harder by the day. The inboard rush of knowledge-intensive jobs threatens a generation of stranded outer suburban households, as Tony has described. Once the suburbs were a force for inclusion, now they teeter on being the agents of exclusion. I now want to turn to what I see as the hard graft rather than low-hanging fruit of urban planning. It's about the software of urban reform, that is, the institutional changes we need to make if the metropolis is to cope with the dynamic forces that I've outlined. Point number one is that the citizens of Greater Melbourne need to take charge of the metropolis because neither the state or federal government are competent or mandated to do so. They do not stand unequivocally for Melbourne, nor does local government, which is only concerned with bits of Melbourne. Ultimately, we need some form of metropolitan governance to take care of planning, water, transport, centres and local economic development, like the Greater London Authority, for those of you who are familiar with that. And like the Greater London Authority, it must be more than a technocratic functionary of the state. It needs some form of democratic legitimacy in its own right. Now, to its credit, the Victorian Government has advanced this cause by establishing the Metropolitan Planning Authority, or MPA, as an arm's length implementation agency for its recently announced metropolitan strategy. We now need to take the next baby step and make the MPA more accountable to the metropolitan constituency. We could achieve this by broadening the governing board of the MPA to include elected representatives from the five sub-regional areas of Melbourne. Sure, the state government would have to share power over the destiny of Melbourne, but the payoff would be bipartisan commitment to an agreed plan for the metropolis. With power over the metropolis appropriately shared between state and local government and a metropolitan sphere of governance, there is much more chance of nimble, high-impact policy around transport, affordable housing, economic development and jobs access. Just as we have observed in London since the restitution of the GLA by the Blair government in the 1990s. And an expanded and democratically mandated MPA would give us a better chance to tackle perhaps the biggest barrier to a prosperous, inclusive and sustainable Melbourne, and that is tax reform. As one of the richest countries, as one of the richest cities in the world, we should not meekly accept that we can't muster the funds to make the infrastructure investments required to transform our city. We certainly pay enough taxes to fund these projects, but the Commonwealth in particular grabs too big a share. In fact, it takes more than 80%. And Canberra is always more inclined to spend on transfer programs rather than infrastructure. Here in Victoria, we could contemplate a revenue-neutral switch between payroll tax and broad-based land taxes, with a significant proportion of these land taxes under the control of a metropolitan jurisdiction. More generally, the state and a new metropolitan government forum needs to strike a new deal with the Commonwealth on untied transfers to the state and our city. This should be performance-based and should be a partnership of peers, not the Commonwealth abusing its excessive fiscal power. The Commonwealth would make untied transfers based on the achievement of mutually agreed targets of national significance around, for example, greenhouse gas emissions, reducing housing stress and better access to jobs. This is how our country was transformed under national competition policy. We could do the same with our city if we really wanted to. Thank you.
It's interesting, Marcus, that we live in a country where the rhetoric is big spending, big taxing governments, and a simple look at OECD figures shows you that we're one of the lowest taxed, lowest spending nations in the developed world. There's a lot of room for change and reform. Dr. Shane Murray is Dean of the Faculty of Art, Design and Architecture, as I said, at Monash University. Shane's an award-winning architect and academic in architectural design. He is a recipient of research funding from both industry and government, including the Australian Research Council, and continues to conduct research into contemporary housing and urban design issues. Shane's building and theoretical projects have been extensively published, and he has participated in numerous architectural exhibitions and forums. He's been invited to lecture about his work nationally and internationally. He was co-artistic director of the Australian Pavilion Exhibition Macro City for the 2006 Venice Architecture Biennale. Shane was the 2012 recipient of the Australian Institute of Architects Neville Quarry Medal for services to architectural education. Please welcome Shane Murray.
Thanks very much, Michael, and good evening, everyone. Now, we disagree slightly on the figures, but by 2050, Melbourne's population is predicted to reach almost 8 million. Of that 8 million, almost a quarter will be 65 years or older. On current projections, we will need at least a million or more new dwellings to accommodate this population growth. Current housing supply is not meeting demand, and we have one of the lowest levels of housing affordability in the developed world. Looking beyond these broad numbers, even if we can meet these challenges numerically, will we be able to house our communities appropriately? Current trends suggest we may not. And this image depicts what might happen if we tried to accommodate that future population growth entirely in the capital city development area of the central CBD and on the fringes. It's really a remarkable encroachment of our urban area. So how should we be thinking about our housing? We need a greater variety of dwelling alternatives that are able to accommodate the diversity of households that make up our contemporary communities. We need more, smaller, affordable and flexible dwellings in the right locations that can effectively cater to the needs of contemporary households. And how can we achieve better outcomes? Inner city high-rise housing development still represents a relatively small proportion of new housing, and this form of housing, while contributing significantly to the vibrancy of our inner urban areas, is neither an affordable or suitable alternative for many people in our communities. High-rise apartment construction is approximately three times more expensive to deliver per square metre than conventional detached housing or low-rise walk-up housing. Now, this image is a provocation that represents an extreme possibility for the Manhattanisation of Melbourne. I think it would be a rather fantastic outcome, but it's unlikely that we can house our entire population group in the central growth in the central city. Greenfield detached housing, while the only affordable option for many, is provided at very low densities with detrimental long-term and socio-economic consequences. One significant area where we could start to achieve affordable and environmentally and socially sustainable housing provision is in our middle suburbs. Small-scale infill housing represents a considerable proportion of current residential building activity in Australian cities, and it plays an important role in the supply of affordable housing. This type of housing development represents a surprising 37% of residential development in Melbourne, but the quality and performance of typical infill outcomes is inadequate for the sustainable transitioning of our cities. The middle suburbs have the capacity to accommodate significant increases in population. However, very few appropriate redevelopment strategies have been realised. Two principal factors contribute to the current lack of effective outcomes in these areas: the individual ownership of middle suburban land titles, which inhibits the assembly of suitable development sites, and an absence of design expertise within the projects that are completed. Infill redevelopments are completed on a lot-by-lot basis, resulting in the repetition of services, building types, car parking, setbacks, and open space provisions, amongst many other things. If the renewal of these lots could be coordinated and strategically redeveloped as a precinct, these provisions could be more effectively distributed across the project to enhance the quality, diversity, and density of dwellings delivered. This precinct-scaled approach offers an economy of scale that could also provide a range of construction and management efficiencies, as well as opportunities for district-wide sustainable infrastructure and public realm upgrades. It also would be an excellent model for the inevitable greenfield expansion that we must endure, and it would eat much less of the land than I previously showed. Low-rise, medium-density development of 3 to 4 storeys is a much more cost-effective way of achieving high-density development and is much more readily accommodated in middle suburban contexts. However, the current community's concern around this form of development is understandable, as they are currently inserted piecemeal into existing contexts on a site-by-site basis with little overall coordination or precinct-level consultation. The state government's proposed new residential development zones with significant scope for local councils to apply local character considerations in the general residential zone and the residential growth zones has, if we're not careful, the potential to significantly restrain medium density development in existing suburbs and continue the current model of atomised 1-for-2 redevelopment. Research at Monash has demonstrated that to date policies to contain redevelopment in designated development areas around transport nodes has not been effective in a number of suburban contexts. If we are to avoid the scenario of extensive greenfield expansion that I indicated earlier and provide housing alternatives in locations that are relatively well serviced, we really do need to engage with the transformation of significant areas of our middle suburbs. These need to move to a denser, more diverse range of housing typologies. We have the technical means and knowledge to do this. However, as with many of the challenges we face in the built environment, we lack the overarching governance, coordination, and consultative processes to achieve such an outcome. This would involve a whole-of-community consultation process where realistic and often challenging scenarios for redevelopment were agreed to at a whole-of-precinct scale. Precinct regeneration offers opportunities to engage with citizens, both owner-occupiers and owner-investors, as partners in development. Results of the do-nothing approach would need to be discussed, stressing to our communities the implicit community building elements that appropriate precinct transitioning would deliver. We would need a brokerage mechanism where available sites could be assembled and land banked in a manner that advantaged both landowners and developers. Smart market principles have demonstrated the possibility of achieving this in other domains. New tenancy and ownership models would need to be developed to expand access to these new housing precincts. Partial mortgaging, housing market shares, and housing bonds are some of the models we might consider. We would need to develop new finance models. Banks would need to consider how their restrictions on development finance might be reconsidered, and other vehicles such as regeneration bonds might be introduced. Current planning is structured to manage impacts rather than to deliver visionary outcomes. We need new types of urban policy that involves government, industry, and community in innovative models for the coordination of planning and investment in our city. I have no simple answer to how we achieve this, but I do believe if we were able to achieve such an outcome, we would bequeath a remarkable future. Thank you.
I think it's probably apposite, Shane, that our supposedly inviolable city boundaries have been exceeded by about 50%, and it's now about 150 kilometres, is it not, from the eastern boundary to the western, which is greater than the distance from the CBD to Bendigo. Dr. Carol Whitzman is Professor of Urban Planning at the University of Melbourne. She's edited and authored a number of books, including Building Inclusive Cities, Women's Safety and the Right to the City. And she's written Suburb, Slum, Urban Village, Transformations in a Toronto Neighbourhood. Previously, Carolyn worked for the City of Toronto on Healthy City initiatives. She has an international reputation for her work on the prevention of violence. Her current research interests include the policy implications of planning for healthy and equitable cities in a national and an international context, planning interventions to increase independent mobility for children, and the development of participatory planning tools with women, children, and people with disability. Carolyn, welcome. Thank you.
Look, it's tough coming to bat. I'm sorry, I'm going to use a North American baseball metaphor. Coming to bat fourth after three such heavy hitters, but I'll do the best I can in the next 10 minutes. I want to be positive, and it's sometimes difficult to be positive about planning in Melbourne, but one of the good aspects of the draft metropolitan planning strategy, and again, like Marcus, I'm talking about baby steps, is a greater recognition of how housing and employment policy might be linked to land use policy. In general, in the past, housing policy has been dumbed down to focusing almost solely on housing supply as an answer to affordability, no matter where it is, and providing a very small amount of social housing, 3-4% of the total housing stock, much lower than other OECD nations, to meet the needs of the lowest 5-10% of household incomes. But as the report of the Ministerial Advisory Committee to the Metropolitan Planning Strategy made clear, there's no part of metropolitan Melbourne where the median price or rent for housing, by the most commonly used measure, 30% of gross household income, is affordable to the bottom 50% of households. That means that at least half of households are locked out of affordable housing. This housing affordability failure has huge impacts, as we've been hearing tonight, on Melbourne's livability, productivity, and environmental sustainability. As we've heard tonight, families are forced even further beyond viable public transport distance from where most jobs and services are located. People also aren't getting the housing they choose, as there is unmet demand for larger apartments and townhouses in inner and middle suburbs, particularly near train stations and tram lines, if they were affordable. Now, the good news that I want to bring tonight is that affordable housing innovation could lead to many more jobs. Housing needs to be planned, designed, financed, constructed, sold or rented, repaired, and renewed. And if we find new ways of doing this in an affordable manner, we could create innovation for domestic consumption and export, create knowledge economy jobs, such as the ones that Marcus was talking about. Now, getting to yes is a research project, and it's a bit innovative in that it's funded by developers and state and local government, as well as the University of Melbourne. So it kind of goes beyond those traditional left-right divisions that Michael was talking about. We've been doing research with those organizations, as well as a plethora of other organizations, some of which are involved in tonight's talk. And our research team includes not only planners, but also designers and also property researchers. We've done a number of research projects in relation to surveys, interdisciplinary studios, but I'm going to be focusing tonight on some good ideas from other places. One of the things we found out through our survey of developers and planners and social housing providers is that there isn't much knowledge about good practices in similar economically booming cities with similar planning regimes. So we conducted a study tour of three North American cities, San Francisco, Vancouver, and Portland. Now, two of those three cities, San Francisco and Vancouver, have similar housing affordability issues. But what all those three cities have in common is that they have managed to provide more oases of innovative, affordable housing in a sea of rising prices in Melbourne. So how have they done this? First, the two U.S. cities have had a consistent federal funding stream through the low-income housing tax credit, introduced, by the way, by Ronald Reagan in 1988. This tax credit has provided a relatively stable source of investment finance, which in turn has led to hundreds of thousands of affordable housing units. Second, all three cities have much more effective forms of capturing development charges than Melbourne does. Through methods like community amenity charges, density bonusing, and inclusionary zoning, all three cities are able to get more money for affordable housing, as well as other vital social infrastructure that we heard from Tony, like community centers, libraries, and improved public transport, out of new development. Third, all three cities have systems to recover additional funding through setting a base level tax rate for areas about to undergo urban renewal. Studiers of Egate and Fisherman's Bend take note, and then accruing a proportion of the increased land value as the areas improve. As is the case with direct development charges, a proportion of the uplift in values goes to affordable housing. This is really simple stuff. Fourth, local, state, and federal government recognize that land is the single largest component of housing cost in these places, and they have systems to provide at least some of this land at low or no cost for social and affordable housing. Particularly in Vancouver and Portland, there are clear community planning processes that link additional population to additional social infrastructure, like community centers and schools. Vancouver and Portland also have family-friendly housing guidelines that mandate a minimum number of 2 to 3 bedroom units and have other design provisions like community rooms and apartments, minimum sizes, minimum storage spaces that help families that want to live in the central city. Finally, all three metropolitan areas support partnerships between charitable organizations, developers, and social housing providers to help simplify the complicated grants realms and help scale up affordable housing. We met with private developers, banks, and construction companies in all three cities who are champions for affordable housing, who see advantages in meeting the housing needs of the majority of households and recognize that investment in social housing is particularly important when there's potential market slowdowns, like during the global financial crisis. All three of these cities are providing quality in my backyard, affordable housing that's built to a higher environmental and social standard, which lowers energy and maintenance costs in the long run. Social housing has been seen as a bridgehead for urban renewal, not something to be stigmatized, something to be built on. So the question is not what to do about affordable housing and jobs. It's how we can get there from here. There are considerable local innovations in Melbourne, and I should say that the study tour involved someone from the development industry, someone from the social housing provider, and someone from local government sector. And what we recognize together is that Melbourne actually has some really innovative design and construction and management models. The question is how state and local government can support a necessary industrial transformation of affordable housing to build on this innovation and to provide good quality jobs as well as more affordable housing for everyone in Melbourne. Thank you.
Thanks, Carolyn. Well, it's over to you. If I might invite the four speakers up to the front.
To what extent is it realistic or desirable to leave it to the market to make the decisions on the future stock of housing supply in Melbourne?
Okay. Carolyn, would you like to start?
Sure. The fact is that 96 to 97% of the housing stock is presently provided by the private sector. What that means is if government doesn't provide basic regulation of that vast, vast majority of the market, we are not going to have any impact on affordable housing whatsoever.
Marcus, that looks to be one that you'd know a bit about too.
Look, I totally agree with Carolyn. It's even with the most efficient market imaginable, that is to say, you know, our regulations are cost effective, we've got good land supply regimes in place, we've got quick development approvals, we have an efficient industry, it's all very, very efficient. It will not provide affordable housing for those people who are in the bottom two quintiles in the income distribution. Public sector investment in social housing was always a mainstream activity of governments in Australia up until really the 80s, and it's dropped off sharply since then, and I haven't heard a good reason why.
Tony, do you want to have a go?
Well, the situation in Victoria is that after the injection of funds into public housing or social housing associated with the global financial crisis, once again, as a proportion of total housing stock, social housing is in decline. And that's showing up in every day in our work and the organisations in the social sector, where underpinning most of the problems that people run into in trying to build a good life for themselves is affordability of housing.
Tax reform was mentioned earlier. Do you think that it would be better to create an incentive through the taxation system for the private sector to come in that way, or would you prefer to see direct injection of public funds?
I think you need both. What we do understand is that you need to think of housing as a system. And so what happens in home ownership affects what happens in the rental sector. And so without thinking, without thinking of it as a housing system, you're not going to get very far.
Shane, I beg your pardon.
But you know, fundamentally, for those folk on the lowest incomes, you just need injection of public monies.
Shane, what's your view?
Oh, well, look, I agree with my colleagues completely. I mean, I think I know that architects often suffer the delusion that affordability can be delivered through some form of efficient construction methodology. I mean, we're now looking to a future where housing may be delivered through unitized construction, where whole apartments are stacked up as building blocks. But we need to remember that the actual construction of the building is only 45% approximately of the overall cost of delivery, and unless we intervene in another way, we can never deliver affordable housing simply through a type of efficiency and construction mechanisms, or definitely not through a totally market-directed housing provision.
Could I just ask a follow-up question? I was thinking more broadly than just social housing. In other words, I'm thinking, can the market be relied upon to meet the needs of different groups in the community? People who are retiring, people with young families and all the like. Because as I said, at the moment, that's not really happening. It's not happening at all. And you can't, as I said, you can't rely on the market to make those decisions because they're influenced by profit and a whole lot of things unrelated to meeting people's needs.
Yeah, but developers aren't the bad guy, or if they are the bad guy, we might as well sort of give up and go home, because they are the producers of the vast majority of housing in Australia, as is the case in other developed countries. I think that it's that with subsidy, with regulation, with support, developers can see affordable housing as more of a win-win. I think that developers, like other folks, find it hard to imagine the kinds of flexible and adaptable models that Shane was talking about without sort of seeing it with their own eyes. I also know that the developers that we spoke to in North America would have collapsed during the global financial crisis without a source of subsidized affordable housing such as was provided by the low-income tax credit. The mechanisms to get the private sector collaborating in building affordable housing aren't rocket science. They've been tried in other places and they've worked in other places. Can the market provide? Well, if the market doesn't provide, then again, we've got a problem, because although I'd love to see a vast scaling up of public and social housing, the fact is that we're only going to be seeing a modest scaling up at best of social housing, and there'll have to be other forms of cross-subsidy, tax incentives, regulation, the kind of systemic approach that Tony was talking about if we're going to see some change.
Would any of the other panelists...
Just a quick comment. You know, when we talk about the market doing something, let's not forget that the market operates within a regulatory framework, and we, the people, are in charge of that regulatory framework. So one of the major shortfalls in terms of providing housing that people need as they get older or as household types change is the very restrictive zoning laws that we have in the city, which are about to get more restrictive, it seems. It's a joint effort. The developers bring the capital and offer the potential to deliver what we need, but we have to get the regulatory frameworks right.
Just on this before we move on, does I'd throw this to all of you, particularly perhaps you, Shane, does supply create demand or demand create supply? Are those zoning frameworks a function of people wanting to stick with a quarter acre suburban block, or were there greater options available, would that create demand for them?
I think if there were greater options available, there would be demand for them. I mean, this is such a complex issue because so many issues outside the actual... Well, first of all, there's the whole question of building typology. We essentially either provide increasingly smaller high-density apartments at construction costs that are three times that of detached or semi-detached housing, or semi-detached or detached housing. There are no in-between alternatives, but we have a radically transforming household profile. So we're no longer a nation of nuclear families. The fastest growing household type is a single woman over the age of 50. But there are no alternatives for these individuals to downscale or find options within the locations they would like to be. And zoning, banking regulations, overall planning legislation, a whole raft of issues play into this. And until we have the type of overall governance structure that I've touched on slightly, but Marcus in a more detailed way has touched on, and more importantly, until we have a type of community agreement where we all take responsibility for a future that could be much better, we really aren't going to move. I mean, we also have a situation in Australia where taxation incentives work against the possibility of providing a greater range of alternatives in our housing provision. We have the highest number of landlord owners in the developed world. There's a huge raft of issues that would probably take several hours to go through, but fundamentally we know what to do. We've seen what happens in other countries, but it's breaking through the silos that somehow keep the various issues that play onto our housing delivery apart from one another and work in self-interest rather than collective interest that's holding us back, I think.
I was wondering what sort of planning reforms do you think would be necessary, both in the planning system and the regulations, to bring about the sorts of changes that you're discussing?
Well, first off, you'd need an actual urban growth boundary that stayed there. Portland's had an urban growth boundary that's remained essentially untouched for the last 30 years, and it was the most affordable of the four cities that we were looking at. You'd also need some housing targets for particular areas. When we talked to folks in San Francisco about inclusionary zoning, they said, well, first off, you need a clear sense of housing target, where you want housing, what kind of housing you want, where, et cetera. And we said, no, we don't really have that at the local government area at the moment. And she kind of gave us this look like, wow, you're really rooted, aren't you? And in some ways we are. Just to get back to the earlier question, we have a Coles-Woolworths duopoly right now. We have small, shonky, central city apartments, generally studio and one bedroom, and we have four plus bedroom suburban sprawl. Do people shop at Coles-Woolworths because they love Coles and Woolworths? Do people shop at Coles-Woolworths because it's a part of Australian heritage? Or do people shop at Coles and Woolworths because it's the only choice available in their communities? I think there's a little bit of this and a little bit of that, but there are definitely signals the government can make to increase the diversity and supply of affordable housing.
Tony?
Well, I think certainly you need an urban growth boundary, but in the development and particularly in the outer areas, I don't think we should be opening up land for development unless we've got the capacity to deliver the sort of social and economic infrastructure that's required there. You know, we just can't keep going building communities where there's no public transfer, virtually no public transport at all, or where there's no facilities for community organisations to locate, to deliver the various services that communities need. So I think the release of land consistent with the ability to deliver necessary infrastructure would be a good reform.
Marcus?
Yeah, look, at the risk of being a bit heretical, I'm not, as an economist, a huge fan of urban growth boundaries. It's got the ring of arbitrariness to it, as if drawing a line on a map's going to change things. I think you could, as Tony's probably alluding to, or I could read into what Tony's saying, if you recovered from the proponents of development in greenfield areas the cost of extending infrastructure so that you made sure that bus services were there, that relevant community facilities were there, schools were there, etc. If they were faced with the cost of that, if they were going out of sequence or into a location which is underserviced, then I think you could rely on the price mechanism to do the job of curtailing the outward spread of the city in a much more efficient way. But if I could just address the original question, what should be in a planning scheme, I'd like to say that it's more about who makes the planning scheme, who owns it, and how powers are divided. I think we know what needs to go into the planning strategy. We've had a succession of them over the past 20 years, and there's basically a consensus of what we need to do. We need a more consolidated city, we need more diverse housing, we need to have a greater emphasis on public transport, we need to develop our employment codes. We know what we have to do. The problem is, the outfit that owns the plan at the moment is the state government, and I repeat what I said earlier, I don't think the state government is in a position to implement the plan. Now, you might say, but they're the state government. Of course they can, but they don't stand for Melbourne. They don't have a direct mandate from the people of Melbourne to implement these things. So when they try to implement something controversial, they find themselves in a sort of a street-by-street, neighbourhood-by-neighbourhood battle with local communities, which always brings the plan unstuck. My answer to that problem is to say we need a metropolitan entity which is democratically mandated, not appointed by state government wholly, which actually owns and makes the plan. It has control over those aspects of the metropolis which are of metropolitan significance, that is, they go beyond the local neighbourhood in terms of their impact, things like the major roads, the major public transport links, the major activity centres, etc. And local governments look after the rest. That might sound controversial, but I would expect it would generate far less controversy and much more rapid implementation of the visions that we've been able to produce but not deliver.
We seem to have a general comment from all of the speakers that this is a no-brainer, and yet we don't get there. And Victoria really, and Australia really, has a very short-term political cycle with a highly emotive political and media-discussed environment. In the three cities that you surveyed overseas, is there different political structures there that help a government or the bodies move forward in a way that creates an effective planning structure? I mean, we don't even have a transport plan at the moment, and yet it's been talked about for 20 years. Is there insights there that you could bring to us?
Well, in all of those cities, the central local government is larger. Certainly Vancouver has the Greater Vancouver Regional District, which is, as Marcus would know, a fairly voluntary group of local governments that together provide some form of metropolitan governance. That would be very threatening in Victoria to state government. I mean, I think we need to accept that, because that would represent 80% of the population of Victoria. And I think the state of Victoria would be very scared to have a body of politics that represents 80% of the economy and 80% of the population. So I think that's part of the reason that stuff doesn't happen. Absolutely, if we had effective metropolitan governance along the lines of the paper that Marcus did with the Municipal Association of Victoria, I think we'd be much better placed to be much more innovative, much more quickly. The bottom line is you've got to get beyond a political cycle streamed metropolitan planning program. We've had five metropolitan strategies over the past five decades. Every time the state government changes, it's considered incumbent on the new government to completely throw in the trash what's been done. And you can't plan that way. You have to plan for the long term. It has to be apoliticized somehow. We're doing a really, really bad job of that in Victoria.
There does seem to be quite a number of fingers pointing at the state government as the main barrier to what has been described as a no-brainer. Duncan, do you want? There's a question, but Duncan, jump in. I could just introduce an audience member here who I happen to know is there, Professor Duncan McLennan, who's Professor of Economic Geography and Director of the Centre for Housing Research at the University of St Andrews. He's done a hell of a lot of other stuff, but he knows what he's talking about. Would you like to jump in?
On the point about Vancouver and different metropolitan organisation, Marcus is bang on in terms of needing to see metropolitan boundaries changing to match the functional systems, as Tony's point about the housing system, that we actually need. But I think the difference in Vancouver and cities like it is the big strategic plan actually doesn't matter that much. What bureaucrats do in and politicians do in Vancouver is they identify chunky bits of the city that they want to change. They buy out land in it. They do compulsory purchase, something that's rather gone out of fashion post-Reagan Thatcher consensus in housing policies. But they do it. They then put together, taking into account public interest, community interest, a master plan for the area. They then do the basis of they auction the planning permission and the master plan. So it's delivered by a private sector in the public interest, and they significantly recoup the infrastructure costs that they've put in within these areas, but they are also, in a sense, taking the planning gain back to pay for the affordable housing. Now, you're right, it's not rocket science, but it's part of a political culture that's developed in Vancouver, and it does it more effectively than any other city I've ever seen. I think in Melbourne, with growth, you have the real capability to do that. We won't actually, when people said, can we use the market? Well, of course, we primarily use the market, but housing markets have huge elements of market failure for older people, younger people, environment, and so on. But we also know that over the last 20, 30 years, as Melbourne has grown, house prices and rents have grown much faster than the incomes of the bottom 20%. So obviously, if we accept this growth outcome of rising property values and flat, relatively low incomes, we won't solve the affordable housing problem unless you have some way of reducing the cost of housing to the lowest income groups, either by subsidy. In a growth city like Melbourne, I think it's shocking that there has not been more extraction of gain to pay for, I would like to see, non-profit housing, particularly for lower income households.
Tony, is that pushing your buttons?
Of course it does.
I think it's interesting.
I find the discussion around governance. So, an observation I would make is that I think people that have been interested in planning our city haven't engaged the treasurers, the treasury, because right around Australia, treasurers are starting to understand that human capital, the development of our human capital, is all important. Particularly here in Victoria, where that's one of our comparative, historically has been one of our comparative advantages, and they also understand that if our city continues to grow as it is, and we have large numbers of young people not completing their education, unable to participate in driving the economy in the future, that becomes a serious economic problem for our community. So I think we've got to engage with the treasurer and treasury, finance and treasury, much more than we have in the past.
Could I just outline some of the ways in which I think housing impacts on jobs? Perhaps most importantly, I think, is that we've got rapid population growth and tax advantages that are driving growth in the demand for housing. And that's knocking up against supply constraints, pushing up land values and house prices. What I think we often forget is that that spills over into the industrial and commercial sectors. It pushes up land values there. Businesses are having to pay higher rents for their premises and so on and so forth, which pushes up business costs and makes our city less competitive. So the long-run challenge that housing poses for productivity and competitiveness of the Melbourne economy is those spillover effects. And unless we address them, in the long run, those rising land values and house prices could, in fact, thwart jobs growth in the future. There are also very important micro links between housing and jobs, because good quality, affordable housing leads to better health. And there's loads of evidence around that. And good health results in low absenteeism and high productivity and more jobs. Good quality, affordable housing tends to be spacious and offers the opportunities for children to advance their education far better than would otherwise be the case. And those better qualified, highly educated children are more productive and we get more jobs. These kind of micro links are not brought out very much in the public debate within Australia about housing and jobs. And finally, and this is the one that I think is a little bit more difficult to accept and discuss, there are strong links, or some evidence that there are strong links between housing tenure and jobs. Now, there are a couple of very well-known economists, Oswald and Blanchfire, who've shown that in the United States, regions that have relatively high rates of owner-occupation have high rates of unemployment.
I'll take that as a comment, and a very good one. Does anybody want to comment on the comment?
Just very quickly, I think Gavin's reminded us, and it's a very good point amongst several points, that a lot of what is driving it, the shape of our city and housing outcomes has actually got nothing to do with the state government or local government. That is the tax regime that the Commonwealth has in place. We have a desperately overly centralised approach to policy making in this country and to the tax regime. And I would be hoping for a more mature conference of peers. I mean, if the Commonwealth was aware that there was a backwash on it in terms of health outlays, in terms of social security outlays, in terms of lost productivity, etc., from it because of the perverse outcomes of its subsidies to home ownership, for example, then it may take a different view of them. So it's a very good point.
I'm from Community Alliance Port Phillip, which is an organisation which has been concerned about social housing over a number of years. And our recent analysis of the impact of the new residential zones in the city of Port Phillip mean that the 19 housing association buildings that have been constructed over the last few years, of those 19, only I think it's somewhere in the vicinity of five might be now developed under the new zoning, which is, of course, a matter of great importance to us because of our history and our wish to continue in the social housing sphere. However, the other thing is that the Fisherman's Bend proposal, which is for 28 hectares of new housing area allocated for into the capital city zone, of that, when the minister opened up that whole area and said, developers, give us your best offers, all of the offers that were made, the 29 that were put forward by developers, were for extremely high rise, extremely expensive, extremely small, and we've done an analysis of two of those, which shows that they'd barely meet standards around ventilation, access, et cetera. So we would like to know, where are we heading with the state government? Why is it that we can't have affordable housing? How come we're opening up new areas and there's no affordable housing or even housing that's decent for people to live in?
Shane, that sounds like a good one to start with you on.
Well, look, I absolutely agree with you around the implications of the new zoning conditions. I mean, it will really work against more flexible, differentiated types of housing in our inner and middle areas. I think it's a really bleak outcome. Our households, our middle suburban areas have been fundamentally transformed, but what we're doing is knocking down one house, putting up two of the same size, often more expensive, with very poor environmental outcomes and really significant consequences to the despoiling of our landscape character in our suburbs, and we could do much, much better. I think the situation with high-rise is extremely problematic. We now have two-bedroom apartments of under 50 square metres as a common outcome, bedrooms that have second bedrooms with borrowed light, no access to ventilation. It's interesting to, in this discussion about markets and intervention, I mean, Sydney does so much better than us in the provision of apartment design, at least because they have a code that restricts the minimum area of apartments and requires us that all apartments have good aspect to sunlight and cross ventilation. So, I mean, I think it really is a serious problem. Much of the issues, though, around affordability are also to do with other forms of intervention, and I mean, my colleagues are much better equipped to deal with that. But I mean, I think the Fisherman's Bend option and the restrictions around the growth zones are really quite terrible in terms of the narrowness of the options they deliver to us.
Would anyone else like to pick that one up?
I would. I mean, thank you for your comments, and thank you also from where those comments come from. Sometimes the state government just goes, oh, we do affordable housing, but it's these bloody NIMBYites that are opposing affordable housing, and here you are from a residents' association pointing out that, as has been the case in Port Phillip, some really valuable social housing has been built there, and that unfortunately, and I'm sorry to dump on the state government, current state government policy is actually making it harder to create affordable housing near jobs and services, not easier. And I would guess, certainly it's been the case in Vancouver and Portland and San Francisco, that if you go to residents' associations and say, look, we're going to have density, let's have a discussion of the form of the density, maybe it will be, as is the case in Portland, six stories along tram lines and then immediately low density in the streets beyond that. And what's more, we're going to be taxing some of the uplift instead of giving enormous uplift, as was the case in Fisherman's Bend, without any kind of capturing the additional value. We're going to get some additional uplift, and gee, there's going to be more people moving in, so maybe we want better public transport provision, and maybe we want more schools, and maybe we want more childcare centres, and a new library and a community centre out of the deal, and maybe a few nice new parks as well. That I think that community groups would be open to that kind of dialogue, open to that kind of social contract. And we haven't been having that mature discussion in Melbourne communities for far too long.
Marcus. Yeah,
interestingly enough, whilst we can take inspiration from overseas examples, as Caroline has been explaining, we can look locally as well. So, to my mind, the equivalent in Sydney of Fisherman's Bend is Ultimo Piemont, you know, an old industrial area that's been transformed into a, you know, multi-use, high-end, in some senses, residential area, but with lots of knowledge economy jobs. But it started its redevelopment phase back in the early 90s. But since the early 90s, it has had an inclusionary zoning scheme in place, which has generated a healthy mix of social housing in amongst this vibrant downtown high-end community, which means that it retains, to a degree at least, its historic social diversity, and everybody's happy with it. So it perplexes me why we've struggled with it here in Victoria. I think sometimes we're a bit uptight in our approach to planning.
Tony, do you pitch these sort of ideas to politicians, and if so, what do they say?
Well, we do, and have done for a mighty long time. I think, looking back on the sort of conversations I've had with politicians, they see the need for social housing, not only for the pensioners and the unemployed and the previous homeless that the Brotherhood might be dealing with, but also for essential workers in some of these communities, you know, the doctors and nurses and et cetera, that need to work close to where they need to live close to where they work. But inevitably, the politician thinks that it's too difficult, that there won't be community support for this. And that's why I'm attracted to the idea that some of my colleagues on this panel have talked about, you know, having mature conversations with the community and engaging the community around some of these issues.
And it would appear from tonight and from the previous meeting that we've had, but there's a lot of enlightenment in the community about this. It needs to come up rather than waiting for things to come down. There was another question up the back here. Thank you.
Actually, my question would follow on nicely, I think, from Tony's comment. I work in the homelessness service system, and we're a little bit like a hamster wheel. We're told to prepare for the population growth and prepare for an increase in homelessness. How would you best suggest that the homeless sector advocate, because we're not being heard by the state or federal government, so where should we direct our energies?
Well, that's a big question. There are a number of aspects to an answer, but the key one, I think, is that we in the social sector have to start thinking and acting spatially. We tend to constantly think in terms of cohorts of people, single mums, we think of the disabled, people that have previously been homeless, etc., without really thinking through thinking through things spatially. So the reality is that in the future, homelessness and already homelessness begins in the outer suburbs. It's not predominantly an issue of inner urban Melbourne. So if we want to intervene earlier, and we need to intervene earlier, we need to think spatially. We need to be thinking about what we need to be doing in those communities that are really at risk of losing the housing. And that more and more is going to be in the outer suburbs. And that's where we as a sector need to place our emphasis in our advocacy towards government about how do we strengthen those communities so that they don't start shedding homeless people.
Yeah, I think that we need to engage with Treasury. As Tony said, the city of San Francisco is also the county of San Francisco, so they're responsible for housing and planning, but they're also responsible for healthcare services. And recently, the city of San Francisco put 8 million dollars towards a new housing project in the central city that provides really good support services to people who are homeless or at risk of homelessness. And when asked why they put $8 million into it, they said, well, we're presently putting $8 million into housing these folks in emergency rooms, so why wouldn't we be spending the money more wisely in permanent housing? I think until we have that kind of joined-up economic thinking that recognizes that if we don't put money into decent housing with good jobs, the money is going to have to come out of somewhere else, whether it's healthcare system or prisons or wherever. Until we get that kind of joined up economic thinking, it's all going to continue to be siloed and not get fixed.
There's a question down the front here.
Yeah, I wanted to bring the issue back to tax if I could. You know, you can read on the front page of The Age one day an article about homelessness, and then if you turn through to the real estate section, you'll see, yay, housing prices have gone up, and we're all a few thousand dollars richer, at least those of us who happen to live within 10 kilometres of the CBD. That's completely tax-free. All those gains are tax-free. Not only that, we can keep gaining that income growth or that wealth growth through our housing and get the pension too, because it's completely separate from it. So I wonder if there's a more fundamental... We've heard about value capture and about broad-based land tax, but what about taxing property in different ways or more effectively or something like that?
And you don't pay tax on the rent you pay to yourself as an owner-occupier. Judy Yates many, many years ago calculated that the amount of money that we spend on home ownership support through those tax breaks absolutely dwarf what we invest in social housing and rent assistance. Look, to be realistic, as we all are, it's very, very sensitive political ground, and I think the only way to sort of inch away to a more sustainable situation is to take up the arguments that Gavin raised earlier, and that is to point out the inefficiencies that are set in train, not just within the housing portfolio, but within the health sector, within our human capital development, within productivity generally. I don't really know what the way forward is. It will take a very brave leader to do so, but somebody hopefully leading from the front rather than following Twitter.
And you haven't thrown in negative gearing?
No.
Which is an extraordinary and unusual policy. Does anybody want to pick up the taxation issue and perhaps mention the effect of negative
gearing? Perhaps if I could just make one other comment, just so it doesn't sound too negative. I do think there is scope, at least within our own jurisdiction, to drop back our payroll taxes, as I mentioned, and increase broad-based land taxes. And maybe that's a backdoor way of achieving this. Maybe this is a way in which we can get homeowners to pay their fair share. But land-based taxes are much more appropriate for infrastructure investment, and they are less prone to economic cycles. So, you know, if we ramped up broad-based land taxes and pulled back our payroll taxes, maybe that's the first step in the journey.
We're very nearly out of time, so would the speakers like to take this opportunity to answer that question as and wrap it up? I'm sorry for anybody else who wanted to ask questions.
Well, I'm foolish enough to comment on the negative gearing because I'm not an economist and I can just be quite blank about it. I think it's really appalling, actually. I think I mentioned when previously that I think in Australia we are unique in the developed world in terms of the number of landowners who are also landlords. Mm. And I think this is a really appalling outcome. We know politically, I mean, Keating and other people have tried to do it in the past, that to impact on negative gearing is very, very risky and unlikely to be undertaken. But I think it really does mean that we overconsume housing so that landlord investors are beating everyone to the hammer in the market. And I think it has a really adverse effect on overall housing affordability. But I'm just a naive architect. I'm sure there are reasons why it could be. Certainly, people who benefit from negative gearing argue a whole range of benefits around the provision of rental housing in the market that wouldn't be achieved otherwise. I do not agree with that argument.
The big difficulty, of course, is politically. I well recall about 7 or 8 years ago, I was at a conference and the head of ACOS asked the then Shadow Treasurer Wayne Swan, why don't you do something about negative gearing? And Swan replied, because he wanted to get elected. And the but I do think that sometime we've got to face up to it, and there ought to be a way in which you could rein it in over a long period of time.
Carolyn?
Well, I'm always left wondering, how does change happen, Michael? I think that, when you have some political leaders with courage, that's one way that change can happen. If you have small pinpoints of light of some really innovative affordable housing that some local governments and some social housing providers have been providing, then that's something that people can learn from and grow from. I think that there, and I'm sure Peter would agree, the person who asked the last question, that there's no one thing that's going to change things. Negative gearing will have an impact, inclusionary zoning would have an impact, metropolitan governance would have an impact. We need to start thinking and talking about all of these things together, and that's how we can make change around jobs and housing in Melbourne.
We seem to have ended up on the first law of public policy, haven't we? The pig with its snout deepest in the trough squeals loudest when you try to pull it out, which is what Wayne Swan was saying. There's 1.4 million Australian households that are doing that. They vote. Can you please thank once again our wonderful panel tonight, Marcus Spiller, Tony Nicholson, Carolyn Whitzman and Shane Murray. Thank you very much.